Dear audience, please be so nice and take a seat, and ideally take a seat in the proximity of our stage, because we would like this session to be very interactive and participatory as well. Please come, don't be shy. A very, very warm welcome to our second panel of today. The time is now, climate change as an accelerator for humanitarian change. Before we start, some brief notes on housekeeping. Welcome to everyone here in Berlin. And also online, we invite you to discuss the intersections of humanitarianism and climate change in the 90 minutes to come. For our online participants, as always, please keep your cameras and microphones turned off during the whole Zoom meeting. Please note that we do have live captions in English that are available for better understanding. For more information, and if there are any technical issues, please contact the user char technical support. For our online and on-site audience, I'm sorry, on-site audience here in Berlin, I would like to stress that you also have the possibility to add your key takeaways of each panel, and also evidently for this important panel, to the boards in the entrance hall. That helps us to access important points, but also maybe you to reflect on the whole process as well. That's for housekeeping, so let's turn to the heart of things. Today, climate change is literally everywhere. We know that in our minds, our individual decision-making processes, when we watch our environment with a careful and sometimes worried eye, for example, when strolling through Berlin in November and it's 20 degrees outside. Climate change is the one topic driving not only discourse inside the humanitarian filter bubble, but it has entered into the everyday news cycle around the whole globe, especially now after COP27 has just ended. And what is more and what is most important and should be most important to all of us, it deeply influences the lived realities of people affected by it. Devastating consequences such as heat waves, rising sea levels, flash floods, storms, and so many more. You know all the facts, you are an expert audience, you know the facts around climate change. 2015 to 2021 were the warmest 7 years on record. We might have already overturned five of the core tipping points influencing the climate already. So we are at a very devastating point at the moment. And why is this important for humanitarian actors? We all know that as well. Humanitarian need is skyrocketing. 2022 broke the records even before February 24th with 274 million people in need. And by last month, this number has escalated to 313 million people in need worldwide. So as of this year, we at the CHAR have started our own research project on climate change and humanitarian change, interested in the effects of climate change on humanitarian organizations in programmatic terms, in operational terms, and concerning also the norms and mandates the sector is built upon. Climate change is an issue of everyone's concern, especially of humanitarian actors whose job and duty it is to support affected populations. To discuss the particularities of climate change and its effect on the humanitarian system, I'm very, very much delighted to be joined by this wonderful round of experts. We have online with us Dr. Kiswendsida Guigma. He joins us from Burkina Faso, where he's based, and he works as a technical advisor for the Red Crescent Climate Center. We have Muhammad Ahmad, the chairperson of the National Humanitarian Network in Pakistan, and last but not least, Paul Knox Clark, who joins us here in his role as the principal of ADAPT, a climate and humanitarian initiative. A warm welcome to all of us. I'm very glad that you're here. Everyone will get a proper introduction right before their individual input to get all the audience on board. I would like to explain what will be heading our way in the next 90 minutes. We will have three consecutive rounds of discussions, each headed by one of our speakers here on stage. They will start with a short input, and then we will have round about 20 minutes to discuss. Content-wise, Paul will speak to the broader level of the humanitarian system vis-à-vis climate change. Guigma will focus on climate science and anticipatory action. And Ahmad will provide us with his expertise and experience, specifically with the context of humanitarian response in Pakistan and questions of localization. Just like in the previous session that I really, really loved, and I was really excited about the participatory manner of our localization session just before, we aim at increasing the participation of you, our expert audience here in Berlin, as well as online. To do so, we have established this fishbowl setup in front of the panel stage that you can all see. So you'll be able to join the circle anytime to post questions and comments to the individual speakers. If you feel you have spent enough time, feel free to make space for others. So please don't hesitate to come and discuss with us. I would love to have this in a very lively discussion. I will do light moderation, so please feel free to engage with all of us here. The only fixed seat is for my colleague Sonja Höfemann, who will be the ambassador for the online questions and comments and will present them to the stage. So, before we start, I would like all of you to get your phones out again, like in the previous session, to encourage you to get involved in our voting. So the question is, the climate crisis is going to change the humanitarian sector in unprecedented ways. Please join us here to click online or through your phones and let us know what you think about this. After that, Paul will start to give his input. Oh, wow. That is a good result. Not so divided as in the last session. So yeah, well, that. So there's still something happening, but the vast majority, I think, we can all see and agree on, agrees with the fact that the climate, the stage of climate change is going to influence the humanitarian sector in ways we have not seen before. So I think this is a good start for Paul to enter the stage. Paul Knox-Clark is the principal of ADAPT, a climate and humanitarian initiative. In his role, he supports humanitarian actors to identify operational and strategic adaptations, as well as he builds awareness of the challenges and supports the transformation processes across the system as a whole. Previously, Paul led research at the ALNAP network, where he wrote the 2018 edition of the State of the Humanitarian Systems Report that you probably are all very much familiar with. And he also was the executive director of Oxford Change Management, an international organization that provided change and leadership support to international organizations. And before that, he worked for WFP and for Save the Children in a variety of humanitarian operations. So he has insight and expertise with all sides of the circle. Please, Paul, the stage is yours. I'm looking forward to your input.
Thank you so much. It's lovely to be here. I'm very honoured to be invited and to be sitting on a panel with such distinguished colleagues. I'm very happy to be here also in Germany, because I think the attention that's been given to this topic in Germany is probably rather more than it is in many other places, although that is happily changing. I'm not sure how I would have voted there, personally, because I think there's a difference between whether it will change, the sector will change, and whether the sector should change. I would like to make the case for why the sector should change if it is to remain relevant in the larger global response to the climate crisis. Whether or not it does that, I think, is a different question. To recap, just to frame some of these thoughts. As you know, the 1.5 degree increase over pre-industrial temperatures is now projected, depending on which projection one uses, to occur but sometime between 2030 and 2035. So that's 8 to 13 years from now. And that matters for a very wide variety of reasons. To humanitarians, I would suggest it matters for one particular reason, and that's this. Because the IPCC says that the transition period between medium impact of extreme weather and high impact of extreme weather takes place between 1 degree and 1.5 degrees, which means that we are in that transition now to a different state, of risk and impact. So what we can expect, and what we're already seeing, but what we can expect in the next 10 years will, of course, differ. There's a lot of uncertainty about what will happen where and when, but I think there is very, very little uncertainty about the general trends. Firstly, and all of this is on top of course, the humanitarian caseload we have already. I think that's very important to underline as well. It's not instead of, it's as well as. We can expect to see much more frequent hazardous events and disasters-related hazardous events. Secondly, we can expect to see those hazardous events being much larger and much more destructive. Thirdly, we can expect some of them, at least, to be also much more complex and uncertain, and to behave in ways that we don't expect, and to behave in ways they haven't behaved in the past. So these are the three challenges that we face at a high level. What does that mean for how we work? I'd like to suggest that each challenge requires a very significant transition. Frequency leads to what one of my colleagues in India has called continuous crisis. Many communities will be experiencing, not perhaps massive crises, but they're massive to them, constant crises. A system that was based on, simplistically, episodic one-year interventions by outsiders is absolutely not designed for that, designed for the exact opposite. And so if we want to a system which can respond to continuous crisis, it has to be local, locally led, locally implemented, and it has to be on the ground consistently working. So that's the first thing. The second, I suggest the issue of much bigger crises, much more impactful crises. Two big changes here. One is about becoming more efficient, and a lot of that seems to be, you know, consensus seems to be one of the ways of being more efficient, using limited resources for far more people, is working more along the disaster risk management spectrum. So being less responsive, which is not a hugely efficient way of working, working more in anticipation, in resilience, or at least getting our act together so that our work is joined up with people who are. That will differ from one agency to another. But the other area is that we will probably come to places where just giving stuff isn't enough. There's just not enough stuff, you know? And a pivot to working on systems, so on the systems that are preventing people accessing labor markets, getting education, having health support, access to social protection, will become much, much more important because these are the systems that can work at scale. The challenge, of course, is how can that be done effectively in fragile states where those systems often, only elements of them exist, although there is learning there. Finally, complexity and uncertainty. Humanitarians tend to have dealt with complexity and uncertainty, I would argue, by trying to reduce it. Yeah? Trying to reduce the window of what is uncertain. So a lot of that is about new public management. We heard earlier on about, you know, reporting and all of the sort of uncertainty avoidance mechanisms that are required. But also a lot of the stuff about forecasting, prediction, contingency planning, preparedness, are all ways of reducing uncertainty, and they're all extremely valuable. But stuff we don't expect is still going to happen, and stuff we didn't plan for. So the other half of that is preparing our organizations to work in an adaptive and flexible manner, which, of course, we heard very good a call for that in the last panel. And that would be my final point. All of those things, a move to localization, a move to nexus-style working, a move to systems thinking and systems working, a move to adaptiveness and flexibility, all of those things are old news. Yeah, it's not. These are not new things for the climate crisis. These are things that the climate crisis, basically, we can do them and be helpful in a much larger response, or we could not do them and be irrelevant. I think that's probably the choice. Yeah, but all of those things have been around since at least, you know, as suggestions, strong policy suggestions, since the GIA in 1996, the evaluation of the response to the Rwanda. 1996 is a long time ago in climate terms. And we haven't got that amount of time to make those transitions now. So we've got to change the way that we think about doing it, or get off the pot. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Paul. This is very intriguing. And before I invite all of you, the expert audience, please get your questions ready. And this includes, obviously, Guigma and Ahmad. You can also jump into the discussion. I would like to ask one one question to Paul. Paul, you have been an expert also, or you have dedicated parts of your career looking into humanitarian change and change management. And if we accept the claim that climate change is going to produce not just more of things, more of disasters, more of floods and heat waves and storms and so on and so forth, but new dynamics with cascading and compound effects, as you have just brilliantly explained, does this level of uncertainty about how it's going to play out in the end also needs new ways of looking at humanitarian change? Do the models that we have to trigger change management tools, are sufficient to face this level of uncertainty?
Shall I respond now?
Yes, yeah. Please.
Well, I didn't know Andrea was going to ask that, but I think you're playing to my strongly held opinions.
Yes.
Here. The current model of, is there a current model of humanitarian change? I mean, there's the model in practice, I think, of what works, and then there is a kind of assumption about what ought to work and doesn't. So let's take the second one first. So if we're going to make a change around localization or adaptiveness, why don't we come up with a policy, identify a couple of champions who are going to take that forward in our organization, do a training on it, and expect that everything is going to be different, yeah? That's the way that we do change in the system. And that's the way change never, ever, ever happens anywhere. Yeah? But if you look at all of, 90% of the historical attempts at change, formally, that is how they've happened. But if you look from the other way at what are the things that have changed, and it's not a huge list in the system, I think you find two groups. Mm-hmm. Things that we actually tried to change and wanted to change, the clusters, cash, and so on. Things or changes that were forced upon us, new public management, technological change, things where we were a very small sector and the world just changed and we had to change with it. For the things that happen because we want to change, I think the common denominators are it's multi-sectoral. It's not turned into a thing. It's led by the experience of people working on the ground, making things happen. But the organizations then, their job is not to control it. that organizations then start to publicize and connect those experiences and put them together. There's information about outcomes, and there's a donor who gets behind it. Mm-hmm. And that constellation of activity seems to be what can help changes to happen. So I think there's, just to sum up, I think there's the thing that we often do about change as if we, and we kind of know it doesn't work because it never has. Mm. And then if we look at the changes that have happened, you start to get a different set of, potentially, of actions that you could take.
Thank you, Paul. So there are a lot of our colleagues here in the audience. Some of them have already taken their seats. Please introduce yourself. Maybe start with Kira here. Introduce yourself, the organization that you are working for, and pose your question, your comment, and engage in the discussion.
Thank you. My name is Kira Fischer. I'm head of advocacy for Action Against Hunger, ACF, in Germany. And I liked, Paul, what you just said about change. And since I'm working on advocacy, you may allow me that I talk a bit more about the political change as well, not just the role of our humanitarian system in it. I think we need to do two things in parallel. And when we talk about multi-sectoral response for ACF, advocacy is also one of the sectors. And so we need for sure the technical operational response. So we need to be more proactive, not just responding. I think we all know that there's a common sense, but we still for sure have to get there in mainstreaming early warning systems, closing the gap to anticipatory action. But at the same time, we should also challenge ourselves, especially as big NGOs sitting in the global north. Mm-hmm. When we look at accountability and who are the biggest polluters causing the human suffering based by climate change already now. And these are, for instance, the G7 member states. And these are at the same time also the biggest bilateral humanitarian donors worldwide, including Germany as the second one in this row. And so I think we also have to see how we address our donor governments in the capitals in the global north, how we challenge them. COP and the loss and damage fund and all the debate around it was already one step forward, still a lot more steps to go. I think we have to be more progressive, provocative. And I know that we don't like, as humanitarians, to talk about rights-based approaches. But when it comes to climate change, probably needs-based is one aspect of it, especially for the response and prevention. But really holding our own governments accountable to invest more in reducing the needs also in the future, but also addressing it now, is one big step to take the challenge. And everything, also when we talk about anticipatory action, I think first we need to talk about the gap between early warning systems and anticipatory action. We all talk about anticipatory action like it already exists in every organization and we are all perfect in it and all donors really invest in it. For sure, it's a flagship for the German government, for instance, and the G7 also tried to push it. But there's also, we need some political willingness to address it. I mean, Somalia right now, we know the pictures in the news from 2011 and same things will occur again. Mm-hmm. But nobody's doing enough to address it right now. So political willingness, political change, accountability of our donor governments in the global north. And this is my last point. And then I make also a little question to our panelists here, sorry. It's also, what is our role as global north-based, mostly organizations? I think also it is about giving the space in platforms like here or COP, etc., to either our colleagues in country offices, our local partners, or maybe even sometimes if it's not too risky for our operations, maybe also activist voices. And we tried, for instance, to bring a colleague of ours from South Sudan to Berlin just 2 months ago, and she got the visa by the German embassy on Monday. Her flight was on Friday. And she got it on Tuesday, and on Monday she would have spoken here. With WFP and so on, about fighting hunger in South Sudan. But it was not possible. At the end, it was a hybrid event. It was okay, but we wanted to bring her in contact with decision makers, with donors, and it was just not possible. So this is, I think, also a challenge for us sometimes. Even though we want to give the space, our visa system is sometimes also hindering this exchange in a meaningful way. And my question to the audience is, to the panelists, what do you think, what kind of alliances maybe are needed now? Because climate change is maybe a different challenge compared to the other ones, or conflict-induced needs, etc. And maybe we have to step out of our comfort zone as humanitarians and have new alliances. So what is your think about that in terms of solidarity and creating change? Thank you.
By incidence, I know that you have just recently published an article together with Matthias Söderberg stressing the humanitarian sector to join up in specific circles with climate activists, for example. So I think that neatly fits the question, fits into this angle. Please, Paul, go ahead.
I just agree with everything you said previously. Oh, not with everything, but with the broad trend. Definitely. The issue of loss and damage, I think, is particularly important. I think it's interesting that humanitarians have really, really not engaged. Some agencies have very, very significantly, but across the board have really not engaged, really didn't engage with it around Glasgow last year, much more maybe this year. But it seems to be such a... there's such a big overlap between the Venn diagram of humanitarian action and the Venn diagram of loss and damage. They're not the same thing, but they are so closely related that to not be engaged in those conversations and to not be, I think, sharing all of the experience we have of what hasn't worked into discussions about loss and damage financing would be a missed opportunity, because we've got quite a lot of lessons, not all of which are positive, about, for example, getting money quickly to first responders. The alliances, I think, I'd be really interested, you said to the audience first, I'd be really interested what people thought, because my sense is it's not a homogenous sector, and not all organisations are going to end up doing the same thing, because there's too much to do. Some will be moving into areas of social protection very strongly and systemic work. Some might be moving very strongly into anticipatory humanitarian response work. Some more into advocacy. And I think that's okay, because actually the humanitarian system, such as it is a human construct which was made to deal with certain kind of global realities. The global realities are changing. I think the shape of that system needs to change as well. And so there will be different interlocutors for different organizations depending on where they need to go. But consistently through that, civil society in affected states and the organizations which represent civil society will be a key point. And I think state, where they exist, state social service providers, we will probably need to be much, and meteorological organizations and other appurtenances of the state will probably need to be much more closely associated with them.
Okay, thank you. I think it's very interesting, and I think it will create more tension if we get more into this question of rights-based versus needs-based approaches. I would like to invite Sonja as an ambassador for the online audience to present what's going on in the chat and include it here in our discussion. Please go ahead, Sonja.
Yes, we have one question on the loss and damage discussion that Kira already pointed to. Saying that when we talk about loss and damage, that it could come up for humanitarian aid. Now that we have at COP27 the loss and damage fund, we also have a German instrument called the Global Shield. But our speaker or our participant, Elisa de Siquira from Doctors Without Borders, finds that both instruments do not go far enough. And here comes a question, and maybe we can direct it to either Guigma or Amat. given that you have also been just with COP and followed the discussions there. So the question goes, how can we make sure that humanitarian aid is not misused for repairing climate-induced loss and damages now and in the future?
Okay. Would you like to respond to that?
Thank you. Is it working?
I think so, yeah.
So, first success was...
not working, I think.
I think it's working. Yeah. Huh? So the first success, I was there at COP, and like we struggle from Pakistan and so is from the rest of the country, and there were pressure group. So the first success was to put loss and damage on the agenda, because this was the biggest issue, and we all were struggling for that. And at the last day, we heard that like loss and damage fund was established or approved by. Now the detail is in the devil is in the detail. How we will mechanize it, it's a bit tricky. And we all need to follow that process up with the support of the German government as well. Mm-hmm. So the civil society must have a seat in the steering committee so that we know what is going on and where the fund is going. And if it is like from the part of humanitarian or like from the rest of the part, or if it is like just tweaking different funding and like we are dealing with the jargon and like the real thing is not happening. So there is a frustration level that does exist. There are apprehensions. Now, as the process will yet start, the principal approval is there. So this is a high time to be on the table and to sit the thing right from the beginning. Otherwise, like, I'm not sure at what will happen, but there is a frustration among, like, especially from the developing countries. And there are apprehensions that it may be more northern-centric again. So, yes, we need to assert ourselves. We need to be conscious about the processes. And somehow, if the civil society or the humanitarian actor or the different actors, if they can have a seat, because mostly it will be the government counterparts, what we are expecting. Mm. But like, if we will have a seat, so that will help us.
Yes. Thank you, Ahmad. I hope we will talk more or get deeper into this discussion also of political action versus humanitarian principles and the leverage of humanitarian actors. Before I want to come to Guigma's presentation, I would like to invite Matthias, who is already prepared to join the discussion. And all of you, please be motivated to get up and just come here to us and discuss with us and pose your questions and comments. Matthias, please introduce yourself and your question.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Matthias Amling from Welthungerhilfe. It's a bit a frustrating discussion, I have to say. I mean, Ahmad, you said frustrating. I agree. We are just coming from another COP, the number 27. It doesn't feel as if it really moves a lot. I mean, yes, we discussed loss and damage, and that's great, but there's so much where we just don't move or have problems even to keep what we have agreed. So that's a frustrating situation, and I would really like ask everyone if we have ideas on how to convey the urgency. I feel we don't, I don't know, we are in a system, we have, I don't know if it's incentive structures, if it is our different systems we are in, organizations, our society, our short-sightedness, but we don't yet feel the urgency enough. Let's discuss how we can change that. That's one point. Secondly, Paul, I completely agree. It's a thing that is much broader. It's not a humanitarian issue. It's a issue of first policy coherence. We have all the 2015 agendas of the Sendai framework, disaster risk reduction of Paris, of course the SDGs. All of that has to go hand in hand. We have to find really like the sweet spots where these things like synergetically work together. It's also about all the different actors, and the local society is a very important one of those. They have to have a seat at the right places. We have to involve all the other actors to discuss how we can now deal with all, with the mitigation, with the adaptation, and with the loss and damage. And maybe as a last point, yes, I feel anticipatory action for the humanitarians. That's one of the things. We should do more. I also completely agree. It's at the moment a concept that has some political momentum and some experience in the last like 10 years, but it's not mainstreamed. It's not at scale, nothing like that. It is also not the solution for everything. That's also important. Sometimes I feel in these discussions now, it's actually used as a buzzword and as a one size fits all solution. That's not the case. It is one bit of a bigger puzzle, one tool in a toolbox. We need to do the mitigation and the adaptation. We need to do disaster risk reduction. We need to keep building up resilience against climate change impacts. But then there is a window of opportunity where we can do anticipatory action. And there will also be the failures again and again. And I mean, Ahmad will also talk about Pakistan now. And we have also to respond then if we see, okay, we have to be prepared to respond fast mm-hmm. and effectively. So I think all of that comes together. But the window of opportunity of anticipatory action is something that we underutilized at the moment, but we also have to understand it. And I felt also yesterday, sometimes we maybe still lack a bit the understanding, we lack a bit of the discussion that we have to have together, how we can meaningfully engage in this area of anticipatory action without just making it another buzzword that at one point no one really wants to discuss again. Yeah. So that's a bit my point. And my question would be really like, how can we convey urgency? And how can we also create stories? We talked yesterday. We need the good stories. We need the narratives of positive change, but also of understanding, making people feel where we are. Thanks.
Thank you, Matthias. I think this is a very good keyword to get to Guigma's presentation, who will speak to the practical challenges and opportunities of anticipatory action. And let's try to memorize your very important question on storytelling and how to really convey the urgency that is necessary to actually engender change. So I would like to invite Guigma now for his input. Dr. Kiswendsida, Guigma is a climate scientist. He works as a technical advisor for the Red Cross and Red Crescent Climate Center. Is based in Burkina Faso in Ouagadougou at the moment, and he is particularly interested in anticipatory action for the humanitarian sector. He has contributed to the development of triggers and actions for flood, drought, cold wave, and heat waves in anticipatory action programs in Africa and the Middle East. Please, Guigma, we are very delighted to have you here. Please join us with your input.
Thank you very much, and hi everyone. I'm sorry I could not make it to Berlin, even if inside of myself I'm not so sorry given the weather that you're experiencing there. this said, I think as our previous participant raised it, it is important to kind of understand what anticipatory action is and where it sits within the disaster risk reduction continuum, actually. So, of course, we also have mitigation, we also have adaptation, et cetera, but we're just talking about the disaster risk reduction continuum and where anticipatory action fits in it. Maybe I'm not sure what is the level of technicality of the audience, but basically anticipatory action is just a mechanism that allows humanitarian funding to be used to take actions within a certain window of time before a certain hazard occurs. And this is based on a scientific forecast, which should have a skillful information. I can just take a basic example. Assume that we know that in the Horn of Africa, for example, the upcoming March to May season, this is very likely. We know that by forecast that it is going to be a significantly below normal rainfall season. Then we can already start taking actions rather than waiting until it happens, and then we just do response. So this is what anticipatory action is. And in terms of where it sits within the disaster risk reduction continuum, you have preparedness activities which are taken long in advance. We know that, for example, we have a region which is prone to droughts, to flood, etc. So we should be sort of prepared to act when a certain situation is imminent. This is basically preparedness. And then we have early response, actually. Once the disaster happens, when the crisis starts, what do we do? This is early response. Then we can have a longer-term response, recovery, and adaptation later. So anticipatory action actually comes in within the time period between preparedness and early response. This is actually to say, just as like the previous participant said, it's not going to solve everything. It is just a new opportunity within the humanitarian sector, but it just comes within a certain window of opportunity. We are not going to solve all of the issues that we have around climate change with anticipatory action. Now, in terms of maybe the challenges that we have in terms in the anticipatory action, there are quite a lot. We cannot list all of them. I'll just take the main ones here. It is, first of all, one thing which maybe the West still doesn't know is that for many hazards, we still lack evidence of the impacts. Mm. And I'm talking about hazards like heat waves, for example, in the global south. When we take the tropical countries, apart from a few countries in Asia, like Pakistan, India, where there is evidence, there is a strong evidence of heat wave impact. Elsewhere, the evidence is not that strong. And as a result, these sort of hazards can go just like silent killers. There is a strong potential to do actions for them because actually we have a good predictability of these sorts of hazards. But unfortunately, there is no political will to go to that simply because there is no strong evidence of the impacts. The impacts are there, but since they are not documented, we cannot do much in terms of anticipatory action. This can be a certain challenge to anticipatory action in many, many conflicts. In parallel to that, we can also have some hazards, some disasters whose impact is really important, but this can be hidden by let's say, higher priority disasters. When you have conflict happening in a certain area, for example, even if floods are quite obvious in terms of impact, even if droughts are quite obvious in terms of impact, the number one priority for the communities living there is to survive until the next day, not even the next season, but just the next day. So as a result, it would be quite challenging to take anticipatory action in that context. This is something to be also aware of. There is a sort of multi-hazard scenario, which is unfortunately growing. Unfortunately, we have many more regions that are kind of impacted by this situation, and this kind of hamper the rollout of anticipatory action to save lives and to save properties. Mm-hmm. There is also, and I think one other participants actually raised that, there is this gap between early warnings and anticipatory action. Many institutions and many political leaders still believe that it is enough to just have the warning, to just know that, as I said initially, in March, April, and May of next year, we are going to have a drought in the Horn of Africa. This, for some institutions, is enough, but this is not enough. When we have the information and we sit on it, we do not make any use of it. We do not build on the opportunity that it is giving us. And we need to kind of work on that. We don't want to have the information and not be able to act based on it. There is also the issue of institutionalization. It also institutionalization and also localization. This talks again to one point I raised earlier. It is the issue of priorities. Of course, with some governments, with some regional governments, they are not aware of the need to take the lead in anticipatory action. Mm. When a certain humanitarian organization like OCHA, like WFP, or even the Red Cross, they get to a certain country, they already have a set of ideas on how they're going to implement anticipatory action, what is the agenda, etc. This might not be in agreement with some of the government priorities. They also may have their own agenda on anticipatory action, mm-hmm. but since they're not, that there is not a good dialogue with these funders, there is a potential challenge when it comes to the implementation. Because likely, those who have the money will go ahead and implement whatever they want. The governments, which generally do not have the resources, will always take on it. But inside of their policies, you feel like this does not fit very nicely. Mm. And this is also something to correct. And maybe one thing to also add is the need for capacity building for both the civil society and also the technical services, the government services in so many places across the world. Unfortunately, we have a civil society which wants to be more involved in climate discussions. They know about adaptation, they know about mitigation, etc. But when it comes to more specific or let's say new mechanisms such as anticipatory action, which are quite obvious in terms of the fruits that they can be, they're still not aware of that. So we need to build the capacity of this civil society in terms of leadership so that they can influence the policies, especially at the local level. And also, as I said, we also need to kind of improve the technical capacity of the government institutions. And in that, I'm thinking of the meteorological and hydrometeorological services mm-hmm. in so many places where they still think that the objective is just to collect climatological data. We need to go beyond that. They also need to leave the comfort zone to kind of make use of the forecast to influence decision-making in their respective areas. I think I will stop here. Still be talking for the rest of the time, but I think we need to have a discussion around what has been presented and also maybe what your concerns may be. If you think maybe that something has not been covered, it's quite good to kind of discuss that. So with that, I will hand over and I'm happy to take any question.
Thank you, Guigma. And please feel free to leave your microphone on and jump into the discussion and at any time. So I think this was very much setting the record straight in many terms on anticipatory action, what actually means in practice and where it has to develop to be actually an on-site tool. I found it very much striking that you've mentioned the lack of evidence in many respects, which kind of also relates a little bit to what we have discussed earlier, that we have to think about, or the humanitarian sector has to think about also alliances with climate activists, but also with climate scientists that need to be streamlined in a better way. There are a lot of operational organizations on site here, so and I guess also online. So I would actually be very interested in hearing reflections from operational organizations also with regards to questions of own agendas of governments vis-à-vis anticipatory action. So please, the floor is yours. Refers to our panelists on stage as much as the ones in the fishbowl. Please, go ahead. I saw that other people are already approaching the discussion. Please introduce yourself.
Yes, of course. My name is Markus Geiser. I'm working for the International Committee of the Red Cross, the ICRC, of course. Maybe a couple of questions, yes? And again, you're all familiar with the ICRC calls about climate change, of course, affecting everyone. But there are some people who, of course, are affected more than others. Yes, and these are the people in fragile conflict zones. And our first panelist very briefly highlighted that, and the last one, as far as I could understand, as well. So just maybe would like to have your based on your research and your experience. We know the figures, 274 million. In humanitarian need, according to OCHA. The ICRC plays 274 million, yes. The ICRC plays around with a term of 66 million people living in areas controlled by non-state armed groups, rebels, insurgents, etc. So based on your experience, has climate-sensitive action been hampered by political reasons, due to political reasons, yes, that, and the last panelist mentioned governments sitting on information and data that, for example, we actually will see, or maybe see already, not for the first time, the non-respect of humanitarian principles, yes, that certain areas may not be covered, yes, by climate-sensitive humanitarian action because these people live in the wrong area. My first question, and then maybe a very practical question, and maybe it has already happened, and please enlighten us, displacement. Are you aware of situations where governments have taken the decision to move people from certain, let's say, non-livable areas? I'm not a specialist, yes, and then what is a non-livable area due to climate change? How is this defined? And then asking humanitarian organizations to help and assist, and what is your advice? Because if you think of all the humanitarian principles we know very well, you can get into a real problem here, yes, so you actually force people to move due to climate change reasons, yes? So what is your advice for organizations? And I stop here. I had another question about anticipatory action, but I can ask it later.
Okay, maybe Guigma, do you want, is there anything in this question that resonates with your practical challenges of your everyday work? I think you have, Marcos has spoken a lot to what is termed otherwise the conflict climate nexus and political agendas behind it. What are your thoughts on those things, Guigma?
Yeah, this is actually one of the most complicated settings when it comes to climate nexuses. I think regarding, first of all, the conflict areas, we at the Red Cross Climate Center, we have a team specially focusing on that question. And what we have unfortunately realized is what you said. Within the Red Cross movement, we have a lot of anticipatory action programs in many countries, some of them being in conflict settings. And unfortunately, what the situation is that, of course, populations which are in conflict zones are also the most vulnerable to climate change. Unfortunately, for these populations, it's not always the case that the anticipatory action programs can reach out to them. Often, what has been tried to be done is to liaise with ICRC. Those who do not know, ICRC is maybe the conflict branch of the Red Cross movement. It is to liaise with IFRs, with ICRC, to see if they can kind of implement the actions for the benefit of these communities. However, ICRC itself doesn't have access to all the areas in some countries. And as a result, there are some people that have been left behind of the climate actions. What are the solutions? This can be quite political, so I don't think I have the answer to that, but the observation is clear. We are leaving many people behind who suffer a lot from climate change impacts, both in the short and long term, but this is simply due to the political situation. Mm-hmm. Now, in terms of maybe the displacements, there is actually an even more complicated nexus between climate, conflict, and migration and displacements. This is quite evident in some places, but in some other, it is less so. And we know that it also depends on the climate hazard, which is driving this nexus. When you have a region which is becoming more and more drought prone, for example, this will force people out of their places, out of the natural places, to go into greener places where they can still do, I don't know, farming, livestock keeping, et cetera, et cetera. This, in general, would lead to some form of conflict, especially with the host communities, because there will be a competition, more competition for the resources, which are diminishing by the way. So this is something which is observed and it is true. Now, the only concern is that actually, they also, at the international level, there are also this trend at easily relating everything to climate change. Mm. Easily, they will say that we have this conflict here, which is actually due to the fact that climate change has done a lot in terms of diminishing the resources for the communities. This will lead them to conflict. But actually, this is not always true, because what is not often said is that climate change is also having some relatively positive impacts in some places. This can be very localized. In some places like the West African Sahel, for example, you have seen that there is a regreening. Let's say the vegetation is improving. Of course, we still have lots of climate issues like floods, for example. But overall, the situation is, in terms of rainfall, the situation is improving. Mm. So if we still want to kind of link up the conflict which is taking place with climate change, it might be false. And if we make a false diagnostic of the situation, the solutions are also going not to work. So we need to make sure what exactly is the nexus between conflict, migration, and climate, and this will depend on each region. This is a really specific situation to each area of the world which needs to be explored.
Thank you, Guigma. I think this touched upon a very, very important point of the conflict climate and conflict climate and migration nexus that I feel, or in my studies on that, humanitarian actors have not been as involved as might be necessary, connected to also those more political and advocacy questions that we have discussed before. Before I would like to invite Ahmad to give his input, there has been another point that is about to be raised, so please share your thoughts.
Thank you. I'm Phan Mantasang from the CDAC network, and CDAC is Communicating a Disaster Affected Community, set up 12 years ago, and I think that point is kind of important to state is that one of the issues looking over the course of this is that a lot of humanitarian action, specifically humanitarian action when it comes to climate change, is reactive. And it's also based on principles, very much based on a short environmental disaster, as in storms or earthquake or conflict. And it's designed to intervene and leave the place as it was when they arrived. Now, the problem with humanitarian action is, with climate change, it's not going to return the way it was. It's going to get worse, increasingly worse. So I think, is it possible the humanitarian system and its funding procedures could ever change to adapt to the fact that it's actually not a response. It is not a reactive, like a firefighter working in. It's going to change. The other thing about point I want to ask was about engagement. We're talking about good stories, let people in the North know, global North know, this is funding the stories. But also there is, we work in a lot of engagement, in the preparatory, is there enough communication letting people know in the areas that a change is coming and it's permanent and explained? A lot of the explanations and discussions are in scientific terms, which are very accurate, but not very well understood by people outside of those circles. So there's definitely an issue there about and where we work about, again, in community engagement, preparedness going forward. It's this humanitarian funding is limited, time bound. But development funding comes from a different area quite often from donors, and it comes from a different funding which doesn't include engagement. The two don't work together, and then you've got to decide, is it humanitarian, is it development? And all the structures we have tend to have these different demarcations based on the world will return the way it was after the disaster is over. Mm-hmm. And preparedness itself is preparedness for a certain time-bound events, rather than maybe, and it's politically difficult, the event is permanent and people have to move. And this raises the spectra, as they say, not my word, but people say, in our discussion there, the worry of migration, which is an absolute part of this when it comes to information about preparedness to the communities that are affected. Mm. A lot of this may be you have to move.
Yep. Definitely. I think this is a good cue to invite Ahmad for his input, because I think he will speak to many of the points that have just been raised, and then we open the floor again for all the people having queued up. Muhammad Ahmad is the chairperson of the National Humanitarian Network in Pakistan. Since 2008, he works also as the executive director of the Initiative for Development and Empowerment Access IDEA, like we have heard earlier today. He is an advocate for localization of humanitarian action and regularly contributes to UN strategic policies and plans. He represents the Pakistani civil society in various national and international fora, meetings with governments, UN agencies, and donors. He has deep knowledge and experience of working in previous emergencies in Pakistan, a country severely affected by climate change. Please, we are very welcome.
First of all, thanks for invitation. I'm a people's representative, so like I may be politically incorrect and maybe blunt, so I'll be sharing some failures and some success stories from Pakistan, as well as the problem we are facing as local actors there, as a civil society. I'm from the background, like Pakistan is currently facing a complex situation. We have a fallout of like Afghanistan crisis. So we were already hosting 1.5 million refugees already, and since last year, we received more. And we are receiving the impact of, in some of our areas where we are hit by the flood as well. So it's a like a security situation over there, and there is like a flood situation. We are receiving the impact of Ukraine crisis because 40% of our wheat was to be imported from. And recently, we received a huge flood, a flood that affected one-third of the whole country. 33 million people affected, 1,700 killed, thousands injured, million plus livestock killed, 13,000 kilometer road washed away, 413 bridges washed away, and hundreds of our like health facilities washed away. And at the same time, we are facing the impact of the COVID on our economy. So like our economy is not in a good shape, as well as there is a political crisis coupled with the rest of the thing. So this is the context we have been operating. I'm representing National Humanitarian Network. National Humanitarian Network has been established prior ahead than the grand bargain. It has been established in 2010 by the local NGOs. So it's a very indigenous network of the local NGOs present at district level, and then they elect their provincial chapter, and then they elect their national. So it's a very democratic and dynamic. And we are running this network since 2010, 99% volunteer basis. So like it was decided initially that if we will be donor funded, so we may got influence. So let's do it. So so far, so good. And then we were part of the grand bargain, and afterward, the localization discussion started. We were part of it. Since then, though there is a frustration, after so many years of discussion, only 2% funding is going to the local actor. So this is the reality of she is advocating for the grand bargain, which is good. It's a good platform. At least there is a momentum, there is a dialogue. But when it comes to the concrete action, everything you need to measure in the in the financial term, so only 2% against 25%. This is like how we are changing, how slow we are changing. And now on the climate change. In the COP, in the 26, there was a lot of talk. In 27, yes, fund has been established and there are a lot of commitment. But we need actions because we are dealing with the lives of the people, the livelihood of the people. We have to rescue them. Time is very much critical in all this paradigm. And we are not realizing it. Everyone is saying we need years and years and years and years to change. Yes, understandable. Like, but is it needed? Is it required that every time we will hit by either Ukraine crisis or by the flood or by something else to get us change? Or we need to be proactive in bringing that change? This is the problem of this sector, and this is the problem not of the humanitarian sector. It's the problem of everyone for here. It's the problem of the government. It's the problem of the donor agency. It's the problem of the UN agencies as well. Huh? But there is a quite disconnect between the humanitarian and development actors. There is no nexus. Now we are working on like the stabilization and the rest of the thing, but like, there is a quiet disconnect. OCHA is coming and then like they are leaving things and like UNDP is coming and like we have to deal with different actors. We, the local actors, are present at the ground. We are feeling the heat. Most of the time we got affected. We are from the community. So recent, I can give you good example. Practical example from the recent experience of the flood. We got hit by the flood in June. Mm. The first appeal was launched on 19th August for 160 million in September. And it was out for 5 million people out of 33 million. Just imagine. And 160 million. And in September, when we checked the FTS, so only 38 million were committed. So let me put it. Timeliness is very much important. If you have identified you are in need of the support in June, and if you are receiving the fund even if less in September, and if it will go into action after 2 months in November, so this system needs 5 to 6 months to translate the pledges into action. And then we realize, and we launch a second appeal about 816 million. And right now, the commitment is 170 million. And meanwhile, a report has been launched for the detailed need assessment, and it was it is by the World Bank and ADB and the UNDP, all the stakeholders were involved, government. It is $30 billion worth losses. And how the world is reacting, 160 million or 70 million after 5 months. So this is not an encouraging situation, by the way. Huh? Now how we are managing it? We have managed the initial 2 months with the community support, with the philanthropy, with the funding from the diaspora. But soon, it is the first response. But after a month, they got exhausted. And there are a lot of other issues on the media. So we need to reduce this time off. If we cannot increase the funding, we need to think how effectively and efficiently we are utilizing that fund. On the, I was not satisfied with my answer to the participant, so let me quote an example. I was in negotiation with two donors for this flood response, for the humanitarian funding. And they said, okay, we allocated 15 million to flood response. It will come to Pakistan. I said, like, and they said, 55 million, I will not name, but like, we allocated for the climate adaptation for Pakistan. Huh? So that's how the humanitarian funding is, if someone is at the ventilator and you are saying, okay, we will build a hospital for you, it will not work. Mm-hmm. Yes, they need emergency response. Mm-hmm. And yes, hospital is very much important. And to deal with the root causes is very much important. But like time determined, when to respond, how to respond. So this is. And meanwhile, we, as we were facing our communities, they are expecting from us. So we reached out to different stakeholders, especially our lead organization, our donor agencies, and to the UN. And we have been hearing all these challenges from the donor. That so we established Ready Pakistan. This is one of the success stories I can quote here. Resilience, ready means resilient, ensuring early action to disaster around the year. This is an acronym. With the support of the START network. So we established this hub so that we can resolve that issue that the donor cannot fund thousand and thousand and thousand of NGO. But like, so now we have a mechanism. We have established mechanism. NGFFO is the first donor. Let me thank them. That they have allocated around 4 million through WHS. Let me thank them as well for the anticipatory action for the disastrous financing to Pakistan. And we, for their flexibility, we requested them that, okay, the fund is for anticipatory action, but now we are very much in response. So they were kind enough that they said, okay, you can use it for the response. So we quickly utilized. In 72 hours, the fund was utilized for the flood response, 1.2 million. So we have now mechanism. We have set model. We are acting what we want the other actor to act like. We have now our own ball game. We are coming up with the example, with the solution for the sector. Please study these models. And if you like it, scale it up. Replicate it in other countries. Because Pakistan is the first hub, and whereby 60% are the local organization, 40% are like the international. So it is not like only localization. It is much more of the coexistence. Mm. It is much more of the co-creation of a balanced humanitarian ecosystem, whereby the government is there, whereby the NGOs are there, whereby the local NGOs are there, and we are now involving the community. And on localization, let me tell you, climate change need climate sciences to be integrated in our system and approaches. So it's not only localization. It's the climate science is very much important to be integrated. So we consulted very well-known universities like Reading University from UK to help us developing these models. So this is one of the success story. And we established this country-based pool fund to have a joint decision-making, to have a joint monitoring system by the stakeholder, government is involved. This is one. The second thing I want to mention, and that is also with the support of the GFFO, through we have different organizations here like WHH, Caritas, DKH, and Malteser. They have started a program together. Together means like towards greater effectiveness and humanitarian action. And we establish HOEFA, Humanitarian Operation and Innovative Funds Facility. So whereby we have free financing and the local organization, they can utilize that funding according to the need for response and preparedness. Now coming to the anticipatory action. We develop anticipatory action trigger for three hazards in Pakistan. It was flood, heat wave, and drought. Four times we were successful with this flood. It couldn't trigger because we developed the triggers on the Indus-based river system, on the river system in Pakistan. And there was a heavy rain in the drought area because of the climate change. So we were not expecting that. And like it was 700% more rain as compared to the routine rain. So we were not expecting that. And no scientific model indicated that as well. So let's, as Paul said, let's expect the unexpected and be prepared for the surprises. So we can have a window for 10 to 15%, and we need not to mix anticipatory action for preparedness and climate fund for like the humanitarian funding or for humanitarian. We need not to be in this very diplomacy. We need to be clear. And we need to have a clear dialogue. And we need not to play with the jargon like localization. We have been, now we are sick of it. Literally, it should be locally led adaptation. Localization is like you are imposing this localization. It should be locally led action with the support of international organization and the scientists like we have in the panel. Sorry for taking a lot of time. Thanks.
I think the time you took was very, very well spent. Thank you so much for pointing out to what works, what doesn't work, and for painting the picture of what happens if it doesn't work, like we have just seen in Pakistan. I think there's a lot of things people that it resonates with people's considerations and reflections, and I think what you have just mentioned is especially the aspect of, first of all, multi-stakeholder views in difference to just, you know, opting always for one. Let's call it buzzwords, may it be localization or may it be the nexus or other aspects that are discussed on one level and don't really trickle down the way they are supposed to trickle down in practice. And the other aspect is time, I think. A lot of things that all three panelists have mentioned, that is the question of the time frames that we think, the time that we need to respond, but also the time that we project things to happen in the future. So with this, I would like to open a discussion, and please, all the panelists, feel free to jump in as well. I would like to give the word to Ole, and then everyone else, please, and also all of you, feel free. And if you don't want to say anything, please make room for others.
Thank you very much. Yeah, Ole from Caritas Germany. Mohammed, thank you very much for these urgent words, and I hope they remain disruptive and intrusive within our minds. Thank you very much. I think whatever we invent, might it be concept like loss and damage, the shield, or approaches like anticipatory action, it will never happen that all people will be protected from the multiple dangers and risk from the climate crisis. because it's not only the loss of life, but also the loss of livelihood, the loss of home, and the loss of cultural heritage. So the vision that all people will be protected from the climate crisis will never happen, no matter which technical instruments we will invent in humanitarian action. Second, no matter how much money we will spend, not all people will be protected from the climate crisis. There's already a huge lack of funding for the current humanitarian needs, and up to 80% of the humanitarian funding needs to be distributed in conflict settings. So no matter how much money we will spend, we will not be able to protect all people from the dangers of climate crisis. And we cannot even tell how much it costs to cover the loss of the harvest, like in Pakistan. I mean, how much of the harvest, of the corn harvest, was just destroyed by the flood. So it's just out of our mind. And on the contrary, I don't know, budget, humanitarian budget or development budget are under fire, you know? There's cut, like next year, in the BMZ next year, probably there will be a 10% cut. You know, we also have more internal issues in Germany, and the first budget which will be under fire is then for the international assistance. So it's a quite difficult dynamic right now. So my question is, or my comment is, would it not be a humanitarian conduct to advocate for a debt relief or a debt cut for many, many countries, to say that the debts which are there since many, many decades should be cut? And the 55 countries most affected from the climate crisis are critical in debt. Many climate funds are delivered through debts, pushing countries into new circles of debt dependencies and so on and so forth. The debt, the historical debts, and the climate crisis has something to do with us, sitting in Berlin, sitting in Brussels, sitting in New York, and so on and so forth.
Yes.
Quoting an Oxfam blog, people are so poor and maybe also so vulnerable to the climate crisis, not because we give too little, but maybe we also take too much from countries like this. So we are not givers of humanitarian action, but we are still takers. So my question just in this round is to maybe to make a relevant point for people in need, and also for the advocacy to Berlin, Brussels, and Washington, to say, do we need to advocate for a debt relief or debt cut for countries affected by the climate crisis?
Yes, sure.
This was one of the agenda. This was what we know the global situation. So we came up in the COP with the solutions. It's okay if this cannot be financed. And this was the Pakistan flood was very much acknowledged by the UN General Secretary as a climate crisis and by the rest of the stakeholders. So we said that a debt payment can be canceled, or at least defer it. Because more than 50% of our budget is going in the debt payments every year. And this is a big issue. So now, if you are not supporting us, at least the good thing is to cancel it. But if you are not canceling it, at least defer it for a few years, yeah, so that we can invest that money for the humanitarian response as well as for like the early recovery and rehabilitation and construction. So this is what we like. There is a frustration. It was time and again acknowledged by the General Secretary, UN General Secretary, at the COP and by other stakeholders, but we haven't yet received any positive response from the globe. That's the problem. We are not asking for cash. We are asking for facilitation, for at least to defer that. On the question of, yes, everyone cannot be covered. But like if you are pledging that we are covering this much people or this much needs, do it timely. Because they will be ticked by the other that, okay, he, like this stakeholder is taking responsibility of this much funding, so I can go somewhere else. And the people affected will be on the wait for months and months and months. And they will not be receiving any assistance from other because like, so this is a very operational issue right now we are facing. That, okay, there are pledges, but they are not being translated into commitment. And if commitment, yet it is taking a lot of time to the donor to transfer the fund to the country level. And it will take a bit of time, maybe months, for the UN agencies who are the prime recipient of to translate that into action. Mm-hmm. So like effectivity can be increased, if the funding cannot be increased, efficiency can be increased, effectivity can be increased. That was my.
Thank you so much, Ahmad. And I would like to invite Patrick and Marie to post their questions before, because we don't have so much time anymore. There's so much to say. After that, I would like to invite our three panelists for a brief final statement of their key points they want to convey to our audience now. But maybe we collect the comments of Patrick and Marie. Please introduce yourself to the audience and to the audience.
I'm Patrick Hamadi from Humedica. A small but global NGO here in Germany, and we've been in Pakistan the last 17 years. Yeah, my comments are just related to the title, If Climate Change is an Accelerator for Humanitarian Change. I think that is already happening to a certain extent. That is mm-hmm. already happening. But I have some points which I would like to share related to what was shared yesterday. Somebody mentioned yesterday, we in the humanitarian have this thing of coming into a place, putting things like on a Christmas tree, putting all the tags on a Christmas tree. But I would like to say that when I look at climate change and the changes that we require in the humanitarian, I would even more qualify that we need a bit of integrated change, proactive integrated change in the humanitarian, the way we do business. What do I mean by this? I think we are in a time when we have all literatures that you can think of in the humanitarian spheres, and now there's this climate change which is going to come up with its own markers. So with the climate fund, it's going to come up with its own markers. So if we don't really consider an integrated change, there's going to be, again, a plethora, so many things coming up which are, we'll be speaking highly complicated language even within ourselves before we speak to the others. That's one thing that I think that is important. The other point that I think related to what has been shared on debt relief, debt postponement, and just generally on our own standard, depending on the context, I think there needs to be certain element of waivers. The earlier session, there was a lot of talk on what is happening in Ukraine, coming up with so many things. I think if we have certain waivers in order to be more effective in delivery of aid, that would be something that would be also important. The last point, coming to Pakistan, I think the issue now is not so much to talk about capacity building, but capacity exchange and capacity recognition. Pakistan has responded very effectively to the crisis that has happened within its own capacity, okay? So there's an issue of, there's been a learning lessons if you look at 2010 and now, the response in Pakistan. So there's that capacity exchange that we should be having more conversation around and capacity recognition to manage these disruptions that will continue to come. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. I think Marie has drawn back from her comments, so I would like to spend the last minute. I think we can overstretch maybe 1 or 2 minutes, our limit, I hope, for that matter, to invite you for your final statements, maybe starting with Ahmad and then Guigma and Paul, to what was spoken, but also to your...
Yeah,
main point.
I would like to respond to that capacity issue.
Yeah.
This is also a very tricky part of the in this very game. It's the local organization basically that are acting as a primary school for the humanitarian and the development actor. But as we don't have equitable salaries packages, so like when we graduate them, they are joining either INGOs or UN agencies. And then they are saying they don't have the capacity. So because of that, we need to be there as an intermediary. And there are a lot of change, a lot of layers of the intermediary. I don't know how many, like in, from the Ukraine we heard. And you then billions of dollars has been spent on the capacity building. And we, when we build the capacity of our colleagues, again, they were offered good packages, and the we cannot retain that capacity. So it's very easy. If you will give us equitable salaries, everyone would like to be at his hometown. Huh? So we can retain that. It's not a matter of capacity strengthening. It's a matter of, like, packages. If INGO, if UN can hire an expert, why not we? We can hire them as well, if we will be able to pay them. On the compliances issue, and let me give you a good example now. In the flood, from the very beginning, it was the local NGOs. We conducted RNA with the technical support of OCHA, but we deployed 200 plus professional to conduct the RNA, the rapid need assessment, voluntarily. More than 50 vehicles voluntarily. When the RNA was conducted and we launched an appeal, the funding is now coming to the UN agencies. And it will come to the local organization after a lot. But like, this is one. Recently, we have a due diligence process by the START network with the support of FCDO for 30 organizations. And mostly fall in tier three, like the top slot. It was not a due diligence conducted by a Pakistani firm, by the international firm. 300 questions were there in the list. And our organization qualified. It does mean that if the donor will come up, if the ECHO will come up, if the German government will come up with the standardized due diligence process, we can qualify that. Or we will judge ourselves and we will graduate ourselves to that level. It is not only for direct funding. It is for the quality funding as well. Yeah. Because at the end of the day, it is we who are implementing the project on the ground. So we need to comply with the global standard, and we want to. But there is no standardized system by the donor. And we request Germany to leverage its influence at least to, like in the European Union, to come up with the standardized due diligence, to at least to have a minimum standard of global compliances. So we will then do our capacity strengthening in whatever way, but we will try to qualify that. We recently, one of our members got elected as a board member of like the core humanitarian standard, and recently 16 organizations passed that certification from. So we are doing on our part. Capacity strengthen should not be used as a for the political economy in this sector anymore.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ahmad, for those very to the point comments.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity to be here. there's so many things that have been said that maybe we can talk about in the break because they're really interesting. I think my overall reflection on some of the conversations that we've had is, first of all, I was very glad that Guigma brought up the point about West Africa and the change in precipitation. I think we can be extremely apocalyptic about this, and we need to be quite careful to look at what the actual problems for which there is a scientific basis, rather than sort of some kind of Hollywood horror story. Having said that, it's also true that the climatic conditions in which we are in are climatic conditions which have never obtained in human history before.
Yep.
Yeah? The last time the climate was like this, Homo sapiens was exclusively in Africa. There was no civilization. There was no agriculture. So everything that we know is changing and is going to continue to change. Which brings me to that rather marvelous Christmas tree. You know, we've got everything is changing around us. The whole environment in which we're working is changing. And I think we've got to kind of get beyond the idea of thinking that we're going to hang a couple of climate balls on the tree. Yeah, because new balls are not going to do it. We've got a new tree. And that's really what we need to be working on. What does that mean, briefly? I think it means we need to primarily get used to the idea that humanitarianism is a tiny fragment of everything that is going to have to go on. And we've got to get much better at playing nicely with all the real power players who are going to be engaging in this. And the point about financing and credit and forgiveness of debt and all of the financial instruments, you know, we need to understand those better. So playing as a minor partner will be a difficult but necessary part of the transformation I feel that we probably need to make. And that will mean changing some of our basic assumptions. It might mean changing assumptions about the meaning of migration, and is migration actually a good in some cases rather than a bad thing, and what does that mean for us? It will definitely, I think, mean changing our assumptions about climate is this thing and conflict is that thing. You know, and we've got humanitarian money, which is only for... There have been attempts for already to identify on the ground climate migrants and conflict migrants. And you can imagine how effective that has been. it's ridiculous. So need is need. And so I think we need to rethink that. And then over that rethinking, as I say, I think we've got to... If we're going to be useful, there will have to be changes about who, where, when, and how we work. But the great thing is, every single organization that I've been working with around climate change has got some of those changes in it somewhere. Yeah, there might just be a one country program. It might just be an idea about how they do shelter so that it can, you know, but the changes are latent. They are actually there. So it's about ramping that stuff up, I would suggest.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you so much. As we are running not only a little bit, but massively over time, I would like to give also Guigma a last chance for final statements before we close the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I think I will try to be very short as I need to rush into a meeting that started about 10 minutes ago. I would say is that anticipation is really key here. It is our best opportunity to prevent the loss of lives, the loss of properties, etc., because we have the opportunity to decrease the exposure. So definitely, we should be advocating more for that, but we need to have, one, the scientific evidence of it. So we need, as the previous speaker said, to build more evidence, and it is science that's going to provide this evidence. And we need to associate the local actors more, not just like implementing actors, but we need to have them from the start. They need to design or to co-design everything which is being planned for them from the start. Otherwise, it is sure that we are going to miss on a lot. And of course, we need more political will. And by political will, I think there is a need for leaders from the global south to be more active rather than waiting to kind of suggestions from the south. They can be more proactive and make the right suggestions at these global platforms for their own communities. I think these are three keys that can help us, let's say, improve the conditions the humanitarian conditions faced with climate change.
Yeah.
With that, I thank you and I hand over.
Thank you so much, Guigma, and thank you, Muhammad Ahmad, Paul Noxlag, and Dr. Kiswendsida Guigma for this very intriguing and indicative points. I thank the audience for their patience. We have run over time. I'm very much aware of this, but also our actions are a little bit, with regard to climate change, it's a little, we are running over time with our actions. So I think it's a little bit, it's a little bit fitting. My last word would be, let's take those comments and reflections raised here to, especially here in Berlin, let us not allow to be frustrated about it, because we should be the last persons to be frustrated about that. Let's get into action and let's do things and let's start. And please stay in contact. Thank you so much for all your great input.